For some voters in Houston, Texas, one of the 15 states participating in Super Tuesday, the likely choice between Trump and Biden was unwelcome. Opinion polls show Trump is the overwhelming favorite in Texas's primary contest, even beating Joe Biden by 4 percentage points.
Oh, I'm terribly frustrated with this country. I mean, the fact that we have Biden and Trump to choose from, it's disgraceful. It's just disgraceful. We don't need 2 octogenarians in office, running for office. There's plenty of other people who are earlier in their careers who could run and do a better job than those two.
Very disappointed. I wish there were 2 better options. Honestly, I hope that Nikki Haley pulls it off some type of way, because I do think the Republican Party needs some sort of reform. I don't think the way that Trump's carrying the party is a positive route forward, but I'm not going to be surprised when it's Trump and Biden.
Millions of Americans in 15 states and American Samoa voted Tuesday, the biggest day of balloting in Democratic and Republican presidential nominating elections. President Joe Biden and former President Donald Trump are expected to win wide approval from their party faithful en route to a November election showdown. VOA correspondent Chris Cascuejo is live in the state of Virginia, where polls closed just a few hours ago. Chris, what do we know about voter turnout in the Super Tuesday primaries? Good afternoon from Manila.
Good evening from Northern Virginia, Arlington, Virginia. We'll talk about turnout in a second, but let's give you some of the latest results. Donald Trump, the former president, is the projected winner in these states, in the GOP primaries in these states: Alabama, Arkansas, Colorado, Maine, Massachusetts, Minnesota, North Carolina, Oklahoma, Tennessee, Texas, and Virginia. Now, the polls were open here in Virginia for about 13 hours, and they closed about 4 hours ago, and VOA spoke with voters leaving the polls.
I voted for Nikki Haley. I'm a registered Democrat.
So that's interesting. Can you tell us what is behind it?
Because I want to do everything I can so that Trump is not president.
I voted for Donald Trump. He's basically the strongest candidate on the Republican side. And the last term he was in as the president, he produced results in terms of both foreign policy and economy.
I mean, I think the main contenders here are Biden and Trump. And when I'm looking at, you know, the history of what both of those candidates have done, mostly for minority groups, I would support Trump in that. You know, being a queer woman, I think Trump has said some very detrimental things to our community, and I have to go with the other option.
So that's some of the voters that were out here in Virginia today at various polling locations. Going into Super Tuesday, Trump had 273 delegates and Haley had 43 delegates. Now, the winner of the person who will capture the GOP nomination needs 1,215 delegates. If Trump were to sweep tonight, he would be 74 delegates short of that measure. And as far as turnout, 6 of the 16 states that were voting today have what are called open primaries, in which Democrats can vote in the Republican primary and Republicans can vote in the Democratic primary. Now, Nikki Haley, a lot of her support, at least here in Virginia, was from Democratic voters who crossed over into the Republican primary to vote for her as a means of preventing Donald Trump from recapturing the White House.
Chris?
Yes.
Yeah, very interesting that you mentioned that, because I want to focus now on Nikki Haley. Even before Super Tuesday, she was very clear. She was very explicit, saying that she's not going anywhere, in so many words. Even after Super Tuesday, it seems as if she's not going anywhere. She's going to stay the course. What do we know about her strategy? What do we know about how she's going to get to the path or get on that path, even if it's a slim one? Chris?
Well, really, mathematically, after tonight, I mean, she might win the primary in Vermont. You know, she's leading with most of the vote counted there, but that's only a handful of delegates. So again, we're looking at the math here. the math needed to get to 1,215 delegates, and Trump is well on his way to that number. So it's really a matter of Haley's own resolve, whether she wants to stay in this campaign and whether the big money donors that she has will continue to back her. Now, we should point out that Haley's campaign has not bought any TV ads in states that have upcoming primaries on March 12th and March 19th. And she has nothing on her schedule tomorrow, which is, you know, we're in the middle of a campaign primary season, and she has nothing on her schedule tomorrow. But she also didn't give a speech tonight. So the jury is out on what she is going to decide, whether she decides anything, you know. Many have been calling for her to drop out, but, you know, we'll just have to see.
All right, let's set our sights now on U.S. President Joe Biden. We all know the stand that he took very early on in this conflict between Hamas and Israel. How evident has Biden's stand on the war in Gaza been in the votes so far, Chris?
Well, there was an effort that started in Michigan to have a protest vote because of Biden's staunch support for Israel and the fact that his administration didn't call for a ceasefire until this week, when Vice President Kamala Harris said there should be an immediate ceasefire for 6 weeks. And then Biden administration started airdropping aid into Gaza, but many critics feel that it's too little and it's far too late. Now, that protest vote effort in Michigan yielded 13% of the vote, people voting uncommitted instead of for Joe Biden in the Democratic primary. And it appears that effort carried over to Minnesota, which has a large Somali American population that's predominantly Muslim. 20% in Minnesota in the Democratic primary, or almost 34,000 voters, voted uncommitted in that Democratic primary instead of voting for Biden.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. VOA correspondent Chris Casquejo there joining us live from the state of Virginia. Thanks again, Chris, for joining us today. Take care.
Good to be with you.
The U.S. now pushing the United Nations Security Council to back an immediate ceasefire in Gaza. A draft U.S. resolution seen by Reuters calls for a six-week ceasefire together with the release of hostages held by Hamas. The text reflects the blunt remarks by U.S. President Kamala Harris, who had called for a pause in fighting last week. Washington had been averse to the word ceasefire. It vetoed three council resolutions, two of which would have demanded an immediate ceasefire. President Joe Biden said on Tuesday, accepting a deal is now in the hands of Hamas, as delegations held a third day of talks with no sign of a breakthrough.
Well, there's got to be a ceasefire, because Ramadan, if we get into a circumstance where this continues through Ramadan, Israel and Jerusalem, again, it could be very, very dangerous. So we're trying hard for that ceasefire.
Hamas, meanwhile, says there will be no exchange of Israeli hostages or Palestinian prisoners until a ceasefire is in place. A senior Hamas official also repeating his group's conditions for a deal, an end to Israel's military offensive, a withdrawal of Israeli forces from the Gaza Strip, and the return of displaced Palestinians to their homes. Israel, for its part, wants merely a pause in fighting, insisting that it will not end the conflict before Hamas is eliminated. El Nino has begun to weaken, but will continue to fuel above-average temperatures across the globe. The World Meteorological Organization says the weather pattern peaked in December and would go down as one of the five strongest in history.
It's now gradually weakening, but obviously it will continue to impact the global climate in the coming months. So even after it disappears completely, we will still feel the impacts of this event. Every month since June 2023 has set a new monthly temperature record, and 2023 was by far the hottest year on record. El Nino has contributed to these temperatures.
El Nino occurs every 2 to 7 years, typically lasts months to 12 months and can provoke extreme weather phenomena such as wildfires, tropical cyclones, and prolonged droughts. Meta's social platforms make that social media platforms Facebook and Instagram now back up after a more than two-hour outage Tuesday. See, last night, more than 640,000 users were booted off the platforms and were unable to log in. Meta, in a statement, apologized for the outage, adding, "It resolved the issue as quickly as possible. It, however, did not disclose the possible cause." The White House National Security Council, meanwhile, says it is not aware of any specific malicious cyber activity linked with the disruption.